strictly. Just for tonight, I'm joined by Anita Rani.
And lucky for us all, we are in the presence of a homegrown screen goddess and Hollywood legend. It's Joan Collins.
Time we saw you, we were just about to throw yourself into the world of panto.
I know.
How was it?
It was absolutely fantastic. I loved doing it, but unfortunately I got, oh my God.
Yeah, you are the
I got swine flu.
Oh, no.
Just before Christmas, yes. And I was staggering around and trying to get on and trying to do my number and feeling really, really ill. And I had to take 5 performances off, which was really awful because I now know what swine flu is. It's not something you want to get.
Which you mention in the book. We'll be talking to you about your new book, The World According to Joan, which Matt and I can't wait to talk to you about. But also members of the public will also be tapping into your wisdom, Joan.
Oh, yeah?
Interesting. All this week on The One Show, we're keeping tabs on David Walliams as he swims the Thames. And as we're going to be finding out later, things are going from bad to worse for him. Look at the despair there.
That's pretty rough. But before we get a progress report from the man himself, let's see what happened when Matt Allwright went to the River Dart in Devon to meet one young man who also likes to take a dip on the wild side. It's dangerous and you should seek expert advice before you have a go yourself.
Absolutely. Now, as we said, David Walliams is on day 3 of his swim down the Thames for the big splash to raise money for sport relief. And here is the man himself at lunchtime today giving us an update on what has been a very, very difficult day.
I need your support.
Joan, how does the thought of swimming 140 miles down the Thames?
Well, first of all, you're not swimming in water, you're swimming in sludge.
You are, that's correct.
I'd rather eat toads.
Okay, well, we'll move on to chickens.
No offence to toads.
Although the number of free-range eggs purchased in the UK is on the rise, there are still an estimated 6 million battery hens in cramped conditions.
And don't I know about it, but thanks to new EU legislation, their cages are about to get bigger, but not that much bigger.
Well, now everybody's heard about the bird.
For battery hens there, but there's another legislation that you're, well, very concerned about, and that's the world of light bulbs. Can you enlighten us on that?
Well, the EU has said that they want to get rid of all of our 60-watt and 100-watt light bulbs, the normal ones that you just screw in. You've got a little thing that goes in like that. And they want to replace them with these twisty ones.
That's right.
Whatever they're called.
Yeah.
The emissions.
Yes,
all that
which
sort of
are filled with mercury if they break. They're very difficult to get rid of. And the light is appalling. I can't read by them. I mean, if I go to a hotel, and they have those because a lot of hotels have got them, you can't read them. I just don't understand why we have to go along with everything that the EU says, because I think some of their rules and regulations, like bananas have got to be a certain shape, and cucumbers have got to be a certain length.
Don't get me started on that.
Don't get me started on that.
For hours talking about that, it's a big deal for me.
Bring back strange shape bananas.
I love Monk and Veg.
Nice. Yeah. Now, your book, The World According to Joan, is full of opinions along those lines. Yes. But it's not a novel, it's not a biography, it's not a self-help book. How would you describe it?
Well, I think it's a light-hearted look at the way the world is according today, according to me, and my opinions about a lot of things that bother me and that I don't like, and a lot of things that I do like. And it has quite a few anecdotes and amusing stories about people I've met. It isn't the menu. It's not a story of my life at all. And I touch on things like makeup and men and morals and manners and values and food and
airports and hotels.
But that honesty is very...
Come fly with me,
It's very... We love that side of you. It's really, really...
You?
Yeah. And it's clear that you have a lot of wisdom. So what we've done, Joan, is we've been out and about talk to members of the public who need your help. So for one night only, it's time to moan
to Joan.
Oh!
Hello, Joan. How are you doing, love? What do you think can be done for the younger generation to stop them writing?
Okay, so it is troubles with writing. How do we stop the writing?
Well, I mean, I think it's a very, very tricky question, because I think that the riots, although a lot of the kids that were rioting were like feral youths, there were a lot of criminals involved, and apparently at the end of a lot of streets, there were people who were receiving television sets and clothes and all kinds of things. I don't know how you stop the rioting. I'm not David Cameron.
Thankfully, it has stopped.
And I mean, what I book is that these kids today have so much more than my generation had. We didn't have anything. We didn't have TV. We had record player and radio. We amused ourselves. And to hear children of, like, you know, from 11 to 18 saying, we're bored, yeah, we don't have anything to do. They have more things to amuse themselves, children today, with their things like that and the internet and the TV and videos and DVDs and everything. Yeah.
We have another question for you.
All right.
This is Annabelle, who's in the gym. Hi, Jane. Something that really annoys me is when I'm walking down the street and I smile at somebody and they do not smile back. What has happened to manners in this day and age? She wants to know about manners, Jess.
Yes, well, you know, it happened to me today. I was doing a walk around the park and I smiled at a gentleman who had a dog and he didn't smile at me back.
Who was that man? Who was that man?
Well, maybe, you know, maybe he was a bit short-sighted. You don't know. But yes, manners, I mean, I do have a whole chapter about manners in my book. I think that, you know, manners just don't seem to exist anymore. I mean, when I go to a door, I expect a man to open it for me, as my husband always does and always would. And if I open it myself, he gets quite cross. And I expect somebody to, you know, carry my bags if I'm at the airport. And I just think the whole thing has just turned into a mess, really.
We can go very quickly to Sarah, who's in the charity bookshop. Here she is.
Hello, Joan. I have a 9-year-old daughter. How do I teach her to be glamorous without being unnecessarily sexy?
Yeah, well, that's a very interesting point, because I know a lot of little girls want to kind of look sexy. I think that she shouldn't wear anything too short. I mean, you know, when I say short, I mean thigh length. And she shouldn't wear anything too low. And she shouldn't wear anything with slogans on that they sell for young girls, saying, you know, I am sexy, or I want a boyfriend.
That's good advice.
Okay, well, in a moment, we're going to make Rob's dreams come true. And let him sit very close to John. There he is, look.
Hold him back. Before that, he takes us back to a time when a particular scientific breakthrough changed modern policing forever.
Well, Jeffries was playing down his discovery somewhat. I mean, what an incredible...
I know, that's what I said to him. You've revolutionised policing. He's like, yeah, well, someone else would have done it, but I didn't.
You have changed the world.
Yeah, what's incredible is that it only happened in the 80s. You'd think that DNA testing has been around for ages, but now we're on the verge of another big breakthrough, aren't we?
It's a very exciting one if it happens. And when I joined the police, which wasn't that long ago, it would take weeks to get a DNA result back. Weeks turned into days, and now, within a year, I'm hearing that we could have, within an hour, results from a crime scene, which really would change policing.
How would it change policing? Yeah.
Well, if you take a scenario, say a burglary, you go to a burglary as a police officer, you find blood left behind by the burglar who's stolen all the property. Well, if you're able to get within an hour round to that burglar's house with all the property that would also ordinarily be sold on, fantastic. Yeah. You've got so much more chance.
Now, of course.
To make this work, though, there's going to have to be a massive database of DNA. I mean, Joe, how do you feel about, you know, giving away all these personal...
Well, it's a very tricky subject, because what could they do other things with that DNA? It could be stolen, and they could become cloned. Mm. They could take your DNA and make another Matt.
I mean, is that such a bad thing, Joe? I don't know.
But maybe if they do... Maybe if it's like babies have to be inoculated, that when the baby is born and they do it then, that might be a better way.
It's one of the ideas that's been bouncing around, actually. Saliva's one of the best ways, bodily fluids are the best. Yeah.
Yeah, but it's going to be very expensive.
But
if the EU say we've got to do it,
yes. Don't get us started on the EU. Don't get a lot of... But Joan, you're no stranger to database, though. You're probably on some customs list somewhere, aren't you? Because you do get into a bit of bother when you travel between LA and London.
Once I got into trouble with customs. I was I'd been in Paris making a movie. And I'd been there for 3 months, and I came back with my 11-year-old daughter and a nanny and assistant. I had lots and lots and lots of suitcases. And Valentino had made me some dresses. Mm-hmm. And I said to the concierge at the hotel, would you send this? Don't send them to America. Send them to my house in the south of France. Well, anyway, he didn't. And the first thing that happens is that the customs man opens it and finds all these beautiful Valentino dresses and Valentino. And he said, what is this? And I said, oh, it's a mistake. And I went bright red and I felt so guilty. And he started taking everything out. And then he started taking out my underwear and stockings. And there were people going by with cameras. Luckily, this was before cell phones. But they were taking pictures. And I was there for 2 hours. And they put me on a database for about 4 years. And I got...
Well, listen, you're talking of people taking photos. All week, Jamie Crawford has been inspiring our viewers to get out there with their cameras. They've literally just been sent to us. We haven't asked for them.
No,
we
did.
Jamie was out trying to take photos of a squirrel jumping on Monday.
Isn't it great? Look at this beautiful one of a robin redbreast, and that's from Jess Stewart Smith.
Good. And from last night's Heron film, this is from Mike Davies. So thanks ever so much for all of those brilliant shots.
Jamie Crawford would be proud. And tonight, he's off in search of the dragonfly.
60 degrees at the same time. Macro.
Great.
It's got his eyes.
Another smile there. Happy to be on the watch. There we go.
Wow.
I mean, we're just talking though there, Joan. I mean, you've been on the front cover of over 700 magazines.
Yeah, well, my first one was when I was 17, so that's a long time ago. And when I was doing Dynasty, I was on magazine covers constantly. In fact, I had a couple only last month. So it's kind of fun.
Talking of Dynasty, Dallas, we know, is being remade with some of the original cast members. Any chance that Dynasty will come back?
Well, first of all, unfortunately, John Forsythe, who played Blake, is dead. And I think that if you did it, you'd want to have the three, you know, Linda and me. I don't know. There's supposedly a script in the works. They've been talking about it. But they are waiting to see how the public receive Dallas. And
that's good. Yeah, good idea. Super.
Good. Well, good. It's been such a pleasure to have you on the show.
Oh, Anita,
it really has.
You.
That's all for tonight. Thanks again to Joan. Her book, The World According to Joan, is available to buy exclusively at Sainsbury's now.
And it is a great read. A big thanks also to Anita. Tomorrow, Alex will be back, and we're joined by a British woman who had a miraculous escape from the 91st floor of the World Trade Center on September 11th, 2001. We'll see you at 7.
Bye.
Bye-bye.